Cody?
No.
He's such a Jake, isn't he?
Mate, how cool of a name, by the way, is Jake Cody? Have you ever? By the way, it's like the coolest name. It's like if you were creating like a soup, you know, like a superhero or something.
Yeah, like Captain, like Captain Britain or something. Yeah, like Jake Cody. Yeah,
a great name. So blessed.
Jake Griffin sounds pretty cool too. Just our powers combined.
And so, well, anytime you get like first name and first name, mm-hmm. you know, like that's how all the actors.
No, but
do
the
it.
Griffin is a pretty popular last name.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But
oh,
like,
is Jake a last name in British culture?
No, but anything that's like Jake Griffin, anything that, where you're like Thomas, Paul, or like David, Rogers, yeah. or you know, like it's got a good ring to it.
You know, it's funny. My parents' names are Nikki and Robin, but a lot of people confuse them because my dad's name is Robin, my mom's name is Nikki, but a lot of people assume it's the other way around, like Robin Wright Penn. You know what I mean?
Okay. Yeah. 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 Yeah, my dad's name's Leslie.
Is he really?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So,
and
okay.
My mother's name is Paul.
Okay, right. Back to the action, guys. We're gonna give you some astounding insights into the world of poker. Yeah. We're gonna give you some high level strategy, believe me. And Jake Cody is gonna raise this for value against Tyler Kenney. And the reason you would limp a hand like this, you would imagine, would be to peel a raise, and that's what Tyler does. And in case you didn't notice, a very strong flop for Mr. Jacob Cody. So strong, in fact, that it's going to be very hard for Tyler to proceed. He could even go like smaller, you know, with like range. Because if you're going to bet some ace highs for protection, mm-hmm. you want to have a very, very small sizing there. But I might just be being results orientated. And if I know Felipe Ramos, and I think I do, this is going to be an open under the gun for the Brazilian superstar. Friend of Neymar. Second place finisher. Go on, Mikey. Punish. See, I think if Maria hadn't called, he might just flat this.
But this is a slam dunk squeeze now because of how he was opening it. Yeah, sorry to interrupt.
You know, I think now you can use it just as sort of as a blockers, squeeze, or... Hmm. And that probably comes down to what Mike was letting us into his strategy of how important it is not to go out for the donut, he feels.
Right.
And as it was, he had everyone dominated, but now he doesn't. So everyone playing a little cautiously. Felipe checking the top pair, top kicker. A little concerned, I guess, by the strength of Maria's flatting range. Mike's going to take a few seconds and then probably release. Maria betting here sort of for protection. A lot of the time, this is the best hand. A lot of the time, she's outflopped a hand like 10s or 8s. Mike calling with ace queen.
That's not Mike McDonald.
I wish we had him on camera to talk about his thought process. And Felipe, with quite a timing tell there, I think, when he snap calls, that he hasn't got a 9. And that he's got kind of the hand he has. And really unusual situation to see three people go to the turn. And I wonder if Mike, I don't think it's really his style, but ace-queen is never good here now, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And like, I don't know.
Just popping out 6,500 in there.
He's actually got sort of the strongest range. He could have 9-10 suited, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not many combos of 9x, 9-8 suited. So maybe he's got what, like... 4 combos? No, he can't find the trigger. And this may well check down now. Maria, considering her options, would you value bet in this spot if you were Maria? I mean, obviously, if you didn't know the hands.
No.
I think Mike can have King Jack as well, yeah? And Mike.
It's not just about Mike. It's also about like Felipe being the third man in here.
Yeah.
I feel like he has a better Jack a fair bit. And what are you hoping to get called by when you bet, right?
Yeah, I know exactly what you're saying. So, Mike also, by the way, has stone bottom of his range, but I just think he can't win. I mean, I don't know what he's probably thinking. I can't win, but what value hand do I go bet, check, bet with here? Mike McDonald.
10-8.
Mate, just make it 8K. And just punish him. Wow, he does go for it. he does go for it, and this is really interesting.
I'm gonna bluff from Mike, because I don't think he takes that line. He doesn't, you know, call flop check turn. I mean, and especially, I don't
bit
think
of a
that I'm good here to overcall. So I guess I'm gonna fold.
Yeah, Mike McDonald with a bit of a loose flop call.
That was kind of interesting from Mike. I don't expect him to take that line a lot with calling flop, check, back, turn, and betting river against both of us, especially when Felipe check called the flop. When Felipe overcalled, basically.
And Felipe, there you see, again, folding
so
queen-ten off.
That was interesting.
To a min-raise.
And I also kind of think that's an interesting check by Felipe. I mean, it's more a two-straight hand than a three-straight hand for ace-jack, I guess, against two opponents out of position. But that was a little interesting. I feel like I lost the minimum, so...
Welcome to the GPL, Maria. You will see some unconventional strategies, believe me. But interesting to see, you know, I particularly hyped Mike McDonald. Showing a little bit of fallibility there.
Yeah.
I think a bit of an ambitious flop call, given the strength of Maria's range, given that Felipe obviously checks some strongish hands there, to float that flop, you know. And also, Felipe did not consider folding in a second.
No.
You know what I mean? So... shows that against this particular opponent, anyway, that kind of strategy. Felipe Ramos does not believe that bet check bet there is a stronger hand than ace jack, you know, and he just sort of snapped it off. I think if he'd overbet, I don't know what he'd be repping if he overbet. So.
Yeah, it's
so.
It's,
so the
yeah.
thing is, you know, it was just a spot where he couldn't win the hand, but you know, Mike McDonald's showing some fallibility, and he can't answer back on the mic, so we can, you know.
I don't think Mike is gonna call out of the small super wide here.
Mike employing pretty loose small blind defending strategy.
Yeah.
This is becoming a little bit more common, but one of the first players we've seen on the GPL employing it. And always kind of interesting these computations when two players have the same holding.
Hello, this is not working right now. Try to type my numbers and they're not working. I mean, I'm obviously gonna see that this flop against both of them.
Tyler Kenney, very deliberate in all of his actions, likes to balance his timing.
And obviously when Tyler calls it, he has, you know, some queens, obviously, you know, all worse queens than mine, you know, because he would be three betting ace queen pre.
So Maria indicating
that he feels good about, you know, betting again here. Like I said, you know, he doesn't really have ace queen here. He shouldn't have aces or kings either pre multi way. He would three bet all those hands, so he really just has, you know, queen jack, queen ten, flush draws. Maybe a five sometimes. Of course he does have some queen nines, but I think my hand is strong enough where I have to bet against two flush draws. I think I could have bet a little bit bigger in retrospect, I don't know. So this is an interesting card. Obviously a backdoor flush comes in here. I don't really see him having a lot of those hands, obviously, unless, yeah, I mean, he really never has any, unless he has four, three of diamonds, I guess.
Maybe ace three and ace four of diamonds might peel off as well,
call,
but.
If he checks, I'm going to bet, I think.
I mean, it's mainly 5x of diamonds, yeah.
Fold.
Yeah.
My range, pretty much. Well, that was uneventful.
So often like we see the guys hype up the hand. It's quite funny when it's a little bit anticlimactic when we know it's just going to go bet fold or.
I felt really good about my hands. Kind of unfortunate that we had the same kicker.
Tyler continuing to limp against Jake, and I think that's a pretty good option. And you can see the way these guys sort of respect ranges. By that, I mean, Jake is the one that has the 3s, 4s, and 5s a little bit more mm-hmm. than Tyler. Tyler might fold a few of the hands that hit this board. So he just checks to him. It's not like these guys fart every flop. They always think about, who is this more favorable, me or my opponent? And also, when it checks through, King High can win him on the river. Jake also aware that he has worse hands than this to bluff, so he can bluff a hand like 10-6, for instance, on this flop, not going to bluff Queen High. So, if
keep
you
keep on giving the Felipe the under the gun marginals.
Under the gun Felipe, we'll call him. He don't hold back, mate. He don't care.
No.
Mate, this is Brazilian poker. I'm loving it.
This is Brazil. Felipe Mojave or Ramos.
Be interesting. I think like the only reason Jakey's paused here is because he's seen how much Felipe.
Yeah. Yeah, he's smirking. He's just like.
The old Jake would have gone for that, I'll tell you now. And here they are, the old adversaries, Anton Wigg and Felipe Ramos. They love to play against each other. Felipe's made like over 60,000 chips from playing against Anton Wigg over the course of the first match. And so again, this is what I'm talking about. Felipe, this board's so much more favorable for the under the gun opener. So he can bet with abandon and not much Anton can do. Never gets check raised on that flop, so he can just fire away with a wide range of hands. So if you're just joining us, we've seen three matches today, two in the European division, the first of which was won by Andrei Patychuk of the Moscow Wolverines. Second of which by London's own Liv Bury, the team manager. First team manager to put a win on the board. They both secured 7 points. Then these guys, with the exception of Jake and Maria.
Very disappointing not to get action with that.
Played a match earlier. And Tyler Kenney, the wild card pick for the New York Rounders, put 7 points on the board for them.
No. It's okay.
Lock it out when I get locked in the door. Jake might be going for an open here, and he's going to get a decent amount of resistance, I think, from one of or both of these opponents.
This is another spot where, I mean, Felipe could potentially squeeze with this hand now. It's not really strong. I think this is, like, too loose. As it is, he's in great shape, but... think flatting here is not really the option. And you can see Mike actually has the strongest hand here, 29% equity. And wow.
Doom switch for Jake Cody here. Flopping three of a kind on the two diamond king deuce deuce board. But Felipe Mojave Ramos, everything coming up the Brazilian in this particular heat. Again, second place in the first match, securing 5 points for the São Paulo Mets and Andre Akari.
So Jake's going to start by betting out here. And Felipe with a quick call on the button. But obviously, Felipe can have hands like sixes, sevens, and the like. He's going to three bet ace-king. So... King Queen and King Jack are the only two kings.
And he might even squeeze King Queen sometimes too. So
some percentage of the time for sure. So Jakey, you would imagine, is going to bet. Also, he's going to want to protect against Ace, Felipe's flush draws, mm-hmm. Ace 8 of diamonds and such like.
Hopefully, Felipe will get a bit stubborn after. shown down a few tight folds in the previous game. It's a pretty easy check fold now. Hopefully he's getting stubborn with eights.
Jake Cody, so aware, realizes when the diamond comes off,
he's not really beating anything.
He doesn't really think he has many worse kings pre. So, that's a advantage.
And even if he did have a worse king, it would probably be king nine suited, so not really.
Fantastic hand reading abilities from Jake Cody. Good ones from you as well, Griff, but you can see both hole guards. And Felipe checks behind himself. And nice pot for Felipe Ramos. But again, you know, similar to Mike's fold with the aces in the first game, you can see how astutely these guys are aware mm-hmm. of their opponent's holding. So many players, you know, if you're new to poker or even into, let's be honest, even at an intermediate level of poker,
yeah.
you know, three of a kind seems like such a massive hand. On that river, he's checking and he's prepared to fold that hand if Felipe puts in a bet. Because there you can see, Felipe doesn't even value bet King Jack. So yeah. let's be honest, you know, if he bets, he's got no real bluffs, calling twice once the flush draw comes in. Jake prepared to fold the hand and, you know, losing sort of the minimum in a very cooler-esque, cooler-ish situation. Cooler-esque, cooler-ish.
It's a spot where I kind of want him to bet, really, because I don't think he ever checks back a bet. A worse answer. I kind of have a worse answer to go for two, so... I'm going to try and take it to showdown, but I really don't think I get to showdown with the best hand very often.
Interesting to see if Mike protects his hand or checks back, does bet. And forces Jake off the same holding.
I think I can peel once on the flop, at least.
It's going to be an interesting hand if Tyler opts the 3-bet here, given that Anton has a very decently sized pair in the big blind. As Felipe remarked in last match, when Tyler starts taking a lot of time pre-flop, he is almost always 3-betting. So it comes as no surprise to the viewers here that that's the case.
Anton just forced to fold. And Tyler picking up a nice pot. And it also... I mean, not that Mike's just going to basically have his ranges in this spot, but, you know, Tyler played a pretty solid strat in the opening match.
Oh, my God.
So, don't think...
Felipe with another massive hand here. He's been running really well in these first two heats for Brazil.
Mate, he has been picking up some hands, isn't it? And, you know, we should remark, he came second last time. He has the chip lead again, and he has two kings. And just a flat. Very... deceptive. And as opposed to when he was on the button versus Jake, where he has a very wide range and he's going to have to check a lot. Here, he has a lot stronger range than Felipe, so he's going to bet a bit wider for value. And it's going to... pretty bad card for Mike's actual hands. I think if a club had come off or a queen, if he'd turned some kind of additional equity, Felipe was going to get a lot of chips. But we shall see Felipe in the tank. And leads out, and we can see that's not a strategy likely to work. Mike McDonald with just ace-jack high. pretty unconventional from Felipe. And, you know, if Mike's got the ace of spades, maybe he looks like a genius, but I don't think you need to have a leading range there.
Yeah.
Or at least, you know, when you block his continuing range so much. You've got the king of spades in your hand as well. Felipe coming in for a raise. And this is going to give us an indication of how Maria intends to proceed. She does defend with the relatively weak holding of 10-7 off. And this is sort of the reason people do defend so wide. You can see Maria, the equity switches considerably in her favor. 80% of the time, she would win at showdown. And you can see the strength of her not slow playing in some way, betting for value and protection with that top pair.
Blind versus blind, you know, that wasn't even that wide, but not really holding many bigs these days.
That's just really a reflection of the state of the game, Sam. A lot of people learning that, you know, the money that you already have invested in the pot, you really should be seeing flops with wide varieties of hands.
Yeah, for sure. In position and such like. Yeah, that's definitely a thing. And Maria, similar to Tyler,
was, you know, opening fairly wide from all positions, actually. And obviously, button's an easy spot for him to open.
Wow. Disaster for Maria Ho here.
Wow. You know, pretty much a full 3x sizing there from the out of position. Top pair, top kicker, looks good to me. I'm just going to go ahead and bet.
And you can see one of the advantages of flatting a hand like this. Maria feeling really confident.
Wow.
What a great turn card for Felipe. Maria thinks that this is a great set of
I still really like my hand. You know, obviously there's a chance that Felipe could be slow playing. You know, a bigger overpair pre, but at the same time, I guess I could have bet a little smaller, jam rivers, but for basically just a little less than pot.
Yeah, this is a bit of a sizing.
Yeah, it's interesting too, because if there's I really genuinely think based on the river.
You know, I don't love that Felipe's called twice here, because I would imagine that he's going to 4-bet shove all bigger aces, you know, like ace king. I mean, he could definitely have hands like 7.
Why did he? Whoa!
Kind of unfortunate.
Whoa!
Because, like I said, I imagine that Felipe, you know, with ace king, he's probably going to 4-bet those hands. So, I think I.
Snap check.
I thought he was going to snap check for sure.
You thought he was going
to
snap check?
Yeah, he wasn't trapping. If he wanted to get it in preflop, he would have got like he wasn't trapping Jack.
Yeah, but she never checks a better hand on the river. I don't think Maria checks.
He's also thinking she doesn't ever call with worse. Like that's just.
Well, I mean, obviously she can just river a 10 with ace 10 of clubs or whatever, and just, I mean that she would jam. But like, I mean.
You're preaching to the choir. I think it's some weak river and turn plays from Felipe, but there's a lot of other things that he's doing really well, which is, I think, contributing to his success so far, like getting really good hands.
And that's a huge mistake, yeah. 30, if you're leaving 30,000 chips out there.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like, I don't think you can try and exploit Maria like that. It's like you've got to play against a tough opponent. You can't be like trying to get away from a jacks versus queen situation, button versus
right small blind.
Yeah, if she's good enough to check like nines full to you there on the river, then like amazing, you know. I mean, not. Good
I mean,
enough.
It's so it's so easy. It's so easy for us to be results oriented in the sense that like she happened to have the stone like top of her like range that was worse than him, which was like ace nine, you know.
Well, who's to say she doesn't 3-bet jack nine or queen nine? We don't know what her strategy is in that situation.
But very good point.
But yeah, I mean, I don't know. It just at least take your time to think about it.
Right.
Like, I think if he really like tanked and was like, okay,
and then you would have been a bit more forgiving. Yeah, but it's like he was just trying to get the showdown right away. Yeah. Interesting turn card here between Jake Cody and Mike McDonald. Felipe, par for the course, running away with the heat.
Mate, Felipe Ramos, what a boss.
Kind of expect him to check back ace hand flop a lot, so definitely increases the strength for this hand. I also expect him to barrel all these gut shots here, so I'm going to call again.
Wow. My boy.
Yeah, that's my boy. Man. Just don't give him a six on the river.
Come on, let's put a king out there. Put a king out there. You think Mike gives up here? Nah. I don't know. This must be the worst hand he gets to the river with, yeah? So. I'm loving it. Such high level play. Can we say that, Griff?
Yeah.
Such high level play. It's so such a delight to not have to hype like a load of rubbish. These guys are brilliant. Go on, Mike McDonald. Stick it in. Jake Cody call king high. Now I'm loving it. Hand of the year.
That would be great.
Mike McDonald in the tank. I think the reason, you know, you got to shove here. I mean, if Jake's getting there, this one.
He gets the river. Pretty much, it's the worst hand, you know, so easy ball.
Damn it, Jake.
Come on, Cody.
Although we could have been bluffed there.
You could have been bluffed. Jake, you donkey. Folding king five high on the river. I mean, what's he doing? He's on nine jack. He's got 9-10. He's got missed hearts. Oh, come on, Jakey. So close. Back in the day, Jakey would have made that call. Back in the Triple Crown days.
This is going to be a limp shove from Jake, I would imagine, pre-flop, but we'll see if Anton takes the bait. He does not.
I think Jake can stab and protect this hand just because he actually does have a lot stronger hands than this, and getting Anton to fold a hand like 6-7 would be a huge result.
Right.
Wonder if Anton feels he has to call with all hearts. No, he folds and you know, because Jake has, you know, the slow plays there, the sets, the big flop flushes. He can bet a hand like 4s for protection, force Anton off a hand with a lot of equity. And once again, let's talk about the start Felipe Ramos has made here. You know, he's picked up some hands. But, you know, electing to flat with the jacks and get, you know, get two streets of value post-flop, flatting with the kings and getting the continuation bet. You know, he's made the most of them in a way. See, I criticized him for that check back, and I do think that is a sizable mistake. But over the two matches, great to see the Sao Paulo Metropolitans putting some points on the board.
They certainly need them going into today. They were in the basement of the Americas Conference with just 13 points and no wins. And through one of the head-ups matches, they've, you know, they're up to 18 points already, so.
Yeah. Still without
clearly
that many,
on their way.
Them and the Rome Rofflers still winless in week 3. And Felipe.
And the Moneymakers winless.
Are they?
Yeah.
Go ahead and check back. I don't see, you know,
and this hand, no need to slow play either. I don't think you need to check the 5-6 here. A little too weak.
One pair
you definitely want to be checking this board with strong hands at some frequency, but
yeah, it's a bit weird line here.
I think like bottom two needs a little bit more. You know, you can check called like 7-8, or I mean, no, that seems a bit results, or 5-4, or whatever, like hands that can have the draw as well. I think 5-6 when you can just, you just get immediate value from all gut shots. I guess he was going for a check shove, but Marie is going to be pretty disciplined. She's not going to probe without any kind of equity.
Against Mike. know, I definitely think I have like a much betting range over his open here. So I don't know. I don't think he's gonna be raising.
Maria's mic not quite up to standard. We will try and get inform her and get that fixed. Mike McDonald taking one of his weaker hands and raising, forcing Maria out of the pot. 10 deuce not flop, doesn't flop exceptionally well, so he'd rather take it down pre-flop. And
like the blinds have gone up so quickly here, it's crazy.
Maria with pretty standard shove on the button.
That king five is a bit loose on the side.
Oh, Jake's berating himself a little bit. I was actually pretty surprised to see him call with that king five.
Yeah, it was pretty boss.
It was really good instincts. He's saying like, oh, he checks back his ace highs. So king high is like a stronger bluff catcher than normal. But still seems a little bit ropey. And haven't seen much of Anton Wigg, who exited in sixth position last match. It's all about Mojave. friend of Neymar, mate.
When you have a friend like that.
They go boozing together. Can you imagine that? Just Neymar like comes to town. Felipe, you're free. Mate, I know you said earlier you slept at Liv Marie's house, but still, that's even better, yeah?
Yeah, a little bit.
A little bit better.
Slept at Phil's house, too.
Oh, mate, can you tell me that story? It's actually one of your better stories. I've got to hand that to you.
Tyler Kenney opening the button here with the 45, the Colt, as I'm calling it now. I don't know. and Anton Wigg, of course, ahead with a pair of 10s. Anton Wigg was, I believe, the first eliminated from the...
Yeah, I
the
just
first
heat,
yep.
Yeah, for sure.
So the San Francisco Rush, alongside the São Paulo Metropolitan, is a bit of a slow start here early in Season 1 for the Americas. So Anton trying to get some points on the board for the homeless millionaire, for Ross Jaca and his team.
Yeah, my boy Galfond let us down a little bit, didn't he?
No, I mean, he'll
be all right. He'll survive.
He always finds a way, that guy. Just when everyone else counts him out. You and I, we're there till the end.
Back in the day when he was on High Stakes Poker, folding a chop. You remember that?
No.
His first appearance on High Stakes Poker, he was like really nervous.
Yeah.
And his hand checked down to the river and he folded a chop for like a...
Didn't Ivy do that at the World Series main one year though?
Yeah. Or maybe that was even the best hand. He folded a flush. I think he had like pocket sevens with a flush. And
yeah, and didn't know. That was Ivy or that was...
That was Ivy, yeah. Your friend, Mr.
My buddy Phil.
You still going with Ivy Poker? How's that going? Are we expecting the site out soon? How's it going with Ivy Poker?
It's going really well, man.
Is it? Cool.
Yeah, check us out at www.globalpokerleague.com and follow the conversation at GPL.
That was a surprise. You thought... Wow. Who did that?
I don't know.
That was almost in time with your...
Yeah,
your joke.
I think maybe they have some sort of comedians back there.
Oh, dear.
Look at Tyler taking 5 minutes to just like pull off some dope bluff.
Just bet 10K. Tyler.
12,000.
There we go, Tyler. I'm loving this. He realizes when Anton takes this line, he's got an 8 or a 10. He does check back the turn with some ace-x. I really like this from Tyler. Really showing his class. Imagination as well.
Yeah.
You know, that's what poker's about. You're not just checking this down, oh, I can't win this. He's thinking, yeah, I actually do. What does Anton check twice? Actually, you know... his range is pretty weak, pretty capped. I do have some aces, extra checks down. 5 high, can't win at showdown. I really would love to see this get through. A lot of imagination from Tyler Kenney. And again, you see he hasn't picked a huge sizing. Sort of looks like it might want to get called.
Yeah.
Really really good play from Tyler. And Anton Wigg in a bit of a coffin here. I mean, what hand doesn't connect with this board? What hand can't show down? Yeah, 5 high. I love to think of Anton Wigg in pain as well.
You know? Why?
Just anti-savanti. He's bashed me up so much. I love to see him in a little bit in the Hurt Locker. Oh, dear Anton. Nice bet from Tyler Kenney showing why he was picked as the wild card for the New York Rounders Excellent stuff. If you're just joining us, he did win game one and secure 7 points for the New York Rounders. Felipe Ramos coming second in that match, who is currently running away with things. And actually, let's be honest, getting smashed in the face by the What's that sound?
Someone, one of them is on their phone.
Oh, right, okay. And Felipe Ramos flopping best. Tell you what, if you couldn't see the whole cards, like if they didn't get to see 10 minutes over, they'd just be like, oh, Ramos is just killing us. And Felipe, with a club in his hand, just going to call. Great turn card for his holding. I think he does, you know, people do moan about the tanking, and like, we don't want to encourage that. But Felipe does give a little bit away.
Yeah,
by like,
for sure.
It's like, if he had pocket fours, you don't just go, snap call, I don't think. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely.
Or if you had like 9-10 of spades for like backdoor flush, two overs, okay, I think I should probably call here. It's like, I don't know. I wonder if Mike's, you know, he was saying himself, as well,
no.
as much as he's, oh dear Jake, seeing the king five.
You think so?
Yeah, I think that's what that no is.
Yeah, definitely.
Just seeing that I got bored.
Mike McDonald with a
doing our first real proper 6-max 3-barrel bluff. I feel like yeah. Seen a couple of nice bluffs in the heads up, but that one was pretty big by Mike McDonald.
And it bricks off. And Mike McDonald, we saw him go for it with the 9-10. I think this is a little bit different. I don't know, like the way it's run off. I mean, Felipe. I mean, unless he picks up on the fact that Felipe did make that tight fold in match one. Mike gives up. Felipe with yet another big pot. Mike McDonald, Maria Ho, Jake Cody, three superstars of the game, all short. And Felipe Mojave Ramos of the Sao Paulo Metropolitans riding high. That is the story of the day. I think this is a good spot for Tyler to open. Anton, Jake, pretty hampered by their stack size. Two blockers. Frustrating spot for Jake. He's going to be forced to fold this hand. I think it's too much to shove. And I could be wrong. He does go for it, and it's a great spot because pretty much everyone has a four. The highest card dealt to the rest of the table is a seven.
Yeah.
So it's always a good spot. I think that's a shove there, 15 bigs.
Watching the stream, didn't realize it was
pure cusp, very cuspy. And who's got dealt the best hand here? Yet again, Felipe Ramos, two tens. And if we skip over Maria Ho, who has five high, you can see Mike McDonald in the small blind, who does want to, says he wants to play solid. Ace Jack, I would imagine, is going to be good enough. It's on Mike McDonald. Felipe should be opening very wide here. And I don't know whether he can pass up this spot. Mike McDonald, ICM knit. We do know that.
Yeah.
Hating life, but he's all in, and he's going to be flipping. Vamoo! Ah, Mike McDonald flopping the ace. See a queen for a sweat on the turn. Yeah, great card. And three jacks. Only improved from two. Oh,
ooh.
There we go. Wow. Pain for Mike McDonald. Get out.
RIP.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Loving that for Felipe Ramos. Mike McDonald, ICM there, out the door in sixth. Said it was important not to get a zero.
Yeah, I mean,
oh
clearly
dear.
Just not taking his advice. Needs to learn how to hold better.
Mate, it's easy to say you don't want to get a zero, but like,
oh yeah, I know.
There's nothing you can do sometimes. And an all-in from Maria Ho Fast and Furious, the action now. Jake Cody with Ace King calls in the big and in a dominating. Wow. I mean, how'd you flop him dead? GG, Maria Ho. Not the debut she would have made, but pretty cool-ed in a spot where she 3-bet Ace 9. Remember, flopped that top pair against Felipe Ramos's jacks and bet two streets with the worst hands. Standard shove, Jake Cody with the ace king. And that's a couple of hands. I mean, Felipe Ramos, how good do you actually run? But a couple of hands really changed the complexion of this second six match of the day in the America's division. Hope Jake is not thinking of doing anything with 6-10. And this might be a defend from Anton Wigg. A suited hand. Obviously, we can see hugely bad shape. Does think better of it. And we've got the Swedish legend on our left. That is Anton Wigg of the San Francisco Rush.
Looking as studious as ever with a...
Mate, it's pretty brutal that Tyler and Felipe know they're our last picks. It's like, Tyler, you have to get heads up. Otherwise, we will not put you on camera. Like, it doesn't matter what you do. Pretty brutal from the producers there. But still nice to have Anton with us. Seen him on the webcam before when he was playing at Timothy Adams' house, I believe. And playing beat Martin Jakobsen. Two games to one.
We're on the board. And we got chips.
Some webcam run good. Mm-hmm. Wonder if he limps. Comes with the raise.
I had to get a better result than the jungle and my teammate Anthony Gregg. So I've been knitting it up pretty nicely.
Wow, real webcam.
Seems to be good to be on camera.
I can defend it.
Although Ace King didn't work out the last time around.
Pretty easy all in regardless, eh?
Jake indicating he is going to be shoving these fours when Tyler raises. And almost certainly going to find ourselves in another flip situation. I'd love to see... Tyler will snap him off.
That's good.
Jake Cody flopping very strongly. Jack of hearts. There we are.
What a good time.
The dream is alive. One more heart.
Dude.
No luck.
Yeah, and let's go.
Jake Cody holding. Crucial swing there, by the way. From out the door to second in chips. Tyler. Wow, Tyler. Okay. Big hand there for Jake. Tyler finding queens with three big blinds. Non-stop action now. At this blind level, and Felipe.
I think this is a call, although I could get squeezed out. Really sleeping. Yeah, I think it's better off.
Anton, thinking better of it.
So.
Ace or a king will eliminate Tyler Kenney. Jake and Anton rooting for an ace or a king as well as Felipe. But Tyler holds and doubles up to about seven big blinds. And that be interesting to see how Anton adjusts, but that puts him under a lot of pressure. He's got to play very tight until Tyler doubles up or busts. And Tyler's going to jam very close.
Closer than it was.
pretty sure this is a call, yeah? Just. What do you think? You should come on, Griff. You must know these spots.
I should have trusted my spidey senses.
Wow, Tyler Kenney, right back in things. Oh, back up nice to 10 big blinds. And it's got some room to breathe.
I really want to put pressure on Anton here because obviously he's going to be waiting for Tyler to get knocked out. But...
So if you're joining us late, we're four-handed.
It's actually a great situation for Felipe to put pressure on me too, for the same reasons. I'm kind of waiting for those guys.
Everyone now has secured 2 points.
2 points, correct.
Next player out gets 2 points. 3 points for third, 5 points for first, 7 points for the win. Tyler Kenney already with a win under his belt. He defeated Felipe Ramos heads up in that first match. Felipe Ramos in very commanding position here with 71k.
Should be just a shove here.
Yeah, I mean, he's only tanking because it's so brutal with Tyler short. Like, to get called here is just a nightmare scenario. It's free roll, Tyler, those points, basically. Very cagey. Tyler Kenney down to five bigs. And if I was Felipe, I'd be just, he should just be 3x opening, I think, here. Because Anton just can't defend adequately. And this is fine and definitely an open, but.
It's just so tight to fold here, but I think it's correct because of the other two stacks.
Get the little peel in.
Do some simple to fold as well.
Holy play.
Wow.
Mingo bongo. Good flop for Felipe as well, considering.
Yeah, of course, because Anton shouldn't hit this board too hard as well. Felipe with a gut shot and a backdoor flush draw. Checks it back and now drawing dead on the turn. And I don't want to say absolutely, but pretty certain that Felipe always has ace high here, yeah?
That's pretty likely, yeah. But then again, he checked, yeah.
Yeah.
We saw Jonathan Duhamel check back a similar hand with pocket sixes on similar board texture, so
and,
you never know what you're going to get.
For stacks for one, two streets here. I buff some straight draws. Flush draws.
Anton correctly identifying, he does have a straight draw.
Since he said he had short on that, let's gotta shove this. Decent result. Obviously wanted the call, but not the snap call. Nice to put some put some distance between me and Tyler as well.
And this is very good from Ramos. We know.
Very good spot.
Yeah. Jake, with the situation of being second in chips, just can't defend adequately.
Oh, they're quite hard to defend this thing.
In normal play, I'm sure Jake would be calling that, but. With the payout structure, with it being so bad for Jake if he busts here in second place with Tyler so short, he's forced to overfold that spot. Very good adjustment from Felipe Ramos.
Should maybe open a little tighter.
And the sick thing is Felipe could actually walk Tyler here to keep the bubble going. You know, it actually is a legitimate strategy to not really want Tyler to bust.
All in the call here. Felipe trying to knock out Tyler.
Eight for the sweat.
Seven.
gut shot for Felipe. A 6 or an 8 needed. No, an 8 or a 7, rather, needed. Bricks off. And Tyler Kenney doubles to 16K. He was down to just two big blinds.
Grinding at a lot of points for the New York Rounders.
Fantastic stuff, exactly. Bided his time, you know, and, you know, and here there could be a cooler. I mean, I think Jake will just call, but, like, potential cooler, you know, if he can stay alive, there's always that chance of gaining more points.
Taylor is giving me the shot box. That's his shit.
I can't just ship this, but I'm actually going to defend.
And as we can see, the correct decision against Felipe's actual hand. Again, just to reiterate, Jake.
And if he sizes it small enough, I'll be calling the pot too.
Jake employing a very cautious strategy because of the points payouts.
Okay.
Tight is right from Jake Cody. Great fold there, I mean, against the actual hand he had. Go on, Felipe, just open the seven deuce, mate.
Yeah. I'm just curious to see what Jake's small blind strat is going to be in this kind of position, but I guess it's going to apply a fair amount of pressure, considering he's got more chips than me and I got less than Tyler does. Yeah, Jake really doesn't want to call it off.
Felipe in the tank. Yeah. Makes the call and Asai is ahead. Tyler Kenney needing a king or a queen. He's battled bravely with this short stack. He will need a king or a queen, or he is out in fourth for 2 points. A queen on the river.
No.
Wow.
No, we got
want to see that.
We got a game going.
These boys. Oh dear.
Nothing against Tyler, obviously, just on those points.
Yeah. So of course you gain points for your team, not just by how you play, but obviously if someone else is eliminated, it's great for you and your franchise to just sort of free roll those points. And this is not going to be big enough, I think, even with a hand as strong as Ace-10, maybe a 3Xing strategy.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Tyler does fold, so what do I know? And if Felipe knew how solid everyone was playing, he'd just be coming in for a big raise each time. So frustrating to have to bow to the ICM situation.
He's getting to the stack where he doesn't really want to. I'm not really sure how often he's really folding into all these stacks then.
Jake Cody in the tank.
That was an equal.
Maybe a bit on the tighter side, not defending. I feel like my...
I think Tyler should probably just shove here.
Too bad that Anton's going to have to put this in the muck.
Serving other purposes.
She's a beaut. Ooh, the temptation is now real for Auntie's Vanties.
Shove.
So what percentage of the time do you think he's going to be shoving this on him?
High equity hand, so good luck to you, Mr. TK.
I mean, sounds like 100%.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. It's like Tyler's pretty polarized when he does this, and you like block that part of his range. I mean, the thing is this.
Well, Tyler might not even call. Like,
no, he isn't gonna call. Yeah. Like, I think once you raise, you can't call off here. Like, you're not in great shape against the range, and it's just awful to flip. That's why I like to shove and just take it out of their hands. Like, Anton's going to fold sevens, maybe eights.
This amount of time, it doesn't seem like it.
I presume, anyway. But so just to make it clear to you guys, maybe a bit newer to poker, if Tyler and Anton are all in, Jake and Felipe benefit so much that in this payout structure where you're gaining points for your franchise, you can't be getting all in a lot.
Yeah.
And that's what's
with
holding
four
them
left
back.
And stuff like that, yeah.
So sometimes, even if they have a small chip edge, they gain chips, they actually lose expectation in terms of points.
Right.
So I was going to say, I almost hope that Jake opens here. Not too fond of, I'm going to raise ace on the bottom with blocker, but not thrilled about it. Open shoving is probably better play, even though Felipe seems to be calling fairly light.
Yeah, that A6 call is going to keep them on their toes, keep them honest, because that was very marginal, very, very marginal call, the way Tyler's been playing.
Yeah.
Bit of a high-risk shove here, but it will go through for Anton.
Yeah, and again, you can see the difference in strategy. Tyler raised
folding
the ace-10, and Anton just using the blocker, realizing how tight his opponents have got to be.
Jake Cody, mate. What are you up to?
Rochdale's number one. See,
that's friendly enough. Just go for the bottom decision.
I don't think like Anton spews here that much. It's like there are way better candidates to like limp jam or limp call against. Do you know what I mean?
Yep.
Like Anton's just so happy to knuckle that I think like an adjustment to raise calling or shoving is better.
Just this wide in this texture. He's showed that he has some type of showdown value.
And now I think Jake should be betting for protection. A lot of straight draws, and obviously that flush draw we can see that Anton does indeed have.
Oh no, really not thrilled about peeling the turn either. Like, it's not that many favorable rivers for me. And I think his range is a bit stronger than it might appear from just checking a bet. So I'm just gonna give the man some respect. So get in. I want to be calling it off. So I better ladder those points.
Anton again sharing so much with us, which is great to see. Similar to how he did in his matchup against Martin.
Situation here
becomes more difficult the more chips he does have to employ this shoving strategy. I wonder if Felipe can resist opening the 3-4 suited. He does. And it's going to be an easy all-in for Tyler. So tense, actually, this corner match. I mean, because Felipe's actually really been dragged right back into it, yeah?
For sure.
It's like...
He has the chip lead now.
I'm saying he's been pulled down to the same stack, you know? Like, they've all got 20 big blinds and Tyler shorter. And so no one wants to bust. No one can really call an all-in too light. Very, very difficult stuff.
I a good outcome.
And Tyler, Kenny, with a very clear all-in, I would suggest. Ace, deuce of diamonds is a very strong holding with 10 big blinds.
And just three guys to get through.
And
a huge hand on the button.
The boss.
What do you think? Is it, you think he's raised
folding? And if not, then shipping.
No, he's raised call. Of course, why would he raise? Why would he raise call? Of course, he's raised folding.
What? That's crazy.
That's correct.
I mean, wow! What a strategy to have. Right, the old raise fold off 11. Off. Wow! Amazing. New York rounders, different class. I mean, that's obviously something.
Yeah, that's well. This is stuff they studied, and they really take this format seriously and really want to win it, and it looks like Tyler Kenney came in really prepared.
Yeah, amazing.
Sometimes you just gotta make a little try.
Yeah, I mean, the whole thing is just you have a blocker,
so,
right?
Just play so well as an all-in. Ace, deuce, diamonds plays better against the high, like the strongest parts of their range. And like Felipe will defend some, presumably, and like everything. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. He's obviously been working on this with, you know, the rest of the New York rounders, Kevin McPhee, and Kenny, surrounded by some of the great mans. So really interesting to see. And perhaps that will prove an effective strategy as the weeks go on.
We have a straight draw that we're pushing.
Certainly values his tournament life because, again, appeal of Jack 10 off. I mean, I think this is pretty good, by the way. And actually, you know, shows how crucial just one pot is when everyone's so evenly matched. Jake Cody opening up a bit of a gap between him and the others.
And Tyler hoping he can get this through.
Yeah.
Oh.
Folds. I don't know, like, what...
Price of poker is going up.
And Jay Cody and Tyler Kenney, you expect them to be clashing here.
Yeah, go on, Jakey.
I can just shove or I can call and fold.
And Tyler Kenney with ace high is the best hand at the moment. If he can hold, he will be right back in this with 10 big blinds. Doesn't change anything. Queen or a jack required for Jake Cody. Otherwise, these stacks are going to be incredibly evenly distributed. 42K, 40K, 40K. And then Tyler Kenny with 26K. This match is still anyone's as we go into the 2,400 level. You remember we'd been at heads up for quite a while at this point.
Yeah. How is it still 400?
Obviously, prefer it. Tyler Buster, but it's also fun playing poker, so you get to do that. Start applying some limbs, see what they do.
Felipe checks, and Anton flops best and has the more strong ace highs than Felipe does in this spot. So he's going to be able to bet this hand for some protection as well.
Guys, Thursday at 3 o'clock, we get the debut of Bryn Kenny himself, Tyler's older brother.
Hashtag BK as well.
Against Le Francois, we all got a very good indication of how talented he is late last week. That's at 3 p.m. Pacific time, 6 p.m. Eastern, if you're on the East Coast in Canada and the U.S., and of course, 12 a.m. Central European time. Do check out that match. Any other future matches you guys want to check out and look into, go to www.globalpokerleague.com. Follow the conversation at GPL, and we're excited to have you guys here.
Yeah, and for those of you who don't know Bryn Kenny, he's a character with some real swagger. Mm-hmm. If we can get him on webcam, he will be a real treat.
Yeah.
The manager of the New York Rounders, real character and one of the most talented poker players in the game.
Yeah, you know, that's really the exciting thing about only being just over 2 weeks into this, you know, this project is that there's a lot of characters you guys still haven't been introduced to, and Bryn Kenny's certainly one of them. The first overall selection of Mustafa Knit, still haven't been able to get him on webcam. So there's a lot of different guys spread out across the league that you haven't seen yet, and Bryn is certainly one of the ones that's going to be colorful.
Tyler flopping best, and again, has the stronger ace highs on this board. In fact, the only one with an ace in this spot, so he gets the bet and win the pot. And Felipe Ramos tightening up, I think pretty correctly, folding the 9-8 suited.
Why do you have to do this? Oh, Jack Tennis. Yeah, but he really doesn't want to get shoved on.
I think this this format now really favors Anton. He's going to be very used to delaying four-handed with pay jump, short stacks. This is what he does online every day as anti-spanty. Someone like Jakey playing more live cash. It'd be interesting to see whether Jake calls here.
Wow, goes for it.
Oh, we're off to the races.
Jake calls with the dominating ace. And this is a big moment for Jake Cody if he wants to secure the win here.
That's a good fault for Tyler.
That's a chop. Jake needs a 9. Tyler needs a 7.
No.
Wow. Heartbreak from Harlem. Tyler Kenney.
7 from heaven.
7 from heaven.
Jake Cody.
Cutting down Jake Cody.
Mate, back in 2002, that wouldn't have flown.
No. 2002,
Jake Cody.
Would not have been acceptable.
And now, Tyler Kenney, who, you know, raise folded the H2 suited, he valued his tournament life. He is now the chip leader after that pot.
Are you learning something, Sam?
Well, mate, him and Fabrice giving me an absolute lesson in why I bust 8th and 12th and 23rd in these tournaments. Unbelievably great stuff. And it's but Felipe flopping very strongly here.
Can't call the folders.
Horrible spot for Jake Cody.
Jake. But why? Such a pro.
This is the match that never ends. It just goes on and on, my friend. Some people started singing it, not knowing what it was. Felipe with the very, very pretty 10 of the clubs. Of green clubs.
Go ahead and limp this. He hasn't been using my limps so far.
I mean, this doesn't seem to be a hand that you want to limp, that you want to raise. I mean, it would work in this situation, but I think a little too depolarized.
Limp shoving it for a bit. An open shoving it for a bit.
Oh.
Okay, here we go.
Jake Cody with a very strong holding with 5 big blinds, but Tyler Kenney will be taking him to the streets. A flip here. Tyler flops best. 7 of clubs for a sweat.
7 of clubs? Nah. Can't beat him.
GG, okay. Jake Cody. Good stuff, mate. Going to be real disappointed there to get outdrawn in a big hand versus Tyler, and three-handed we are now, and Tyler Kenney is your chip leader.
Wow.
Ladies and gentlemen,
if he's still able to get a first place finish once again here for the New York Rounders,
second place, and then
he will be unequivocally the best player of the GPL so far this
interesting
quickly.
300. this price. Definitely. Defending hands like this.
Anton defends the king high. And this is a pretty good check, I think, given that he doesn't have any ace-x. And it's pretty hard to get outdrawn. Obviously, he does have one overcard. I guess maybe if you've got such a range of eyes on this board, you can just should just bet everything.
Getting you a very good price, but I don't expect.
I guess this is fine. You can get value from a 10 or 4. And we are joined again by Tyler Kenney.
Maybe I'm wrong.
The main event, the kid.
No, I also didn't think he was
gonna bet. Mike Corleone himself. No. Half the chips in play with three left. Doing it once again.
Because
this is New York. Concrete jungle where dreams are made of.
And whatever happens, Felipe and Tyler, it's going to be a great day's work for them. Both getting into the top three. They came first and second last time. Top three this time.
Sure or not.
Fantastic for those guys.
It's in the call button often enough. See, let these guys duke it out.
Now, Felipe, who's been a little bit card dead, picking up a hand.
Bold. Good spot for Tyler to apply a bunch of pressure. But I can't really do anything with the deuce and eight.
That means I can't hear what the heck is going on in the game, but that's cool. We're three-handed. I think I kind of understand what's going to happen.
Tyler Kenney with a bit of swagger, loving it.
He's might go. Ooh, whoa. What are you gonna do, Felipe? You can't go all in. I mean,
you can.
Like 20, close to 20 blinds, but it's a pay jump. I'm just going to win four. I'm gonna check. I think I'm gonna check.
And this is a very strong hand for a strong flop for Felipe. Obviously, these guys both with ace high. You can see Tyler will only win this hand 7% of the time. Felipe with 47% equity. See, quite often it will be a chop.
It's close, I guess. There's a lot of blinds to shove. I could 3-bet, I guess. I probably should 3-bet, I think, in that spot instead of just checking.
And
I think that's a mistake. It's all good.
Felipe coming in for a raise.
We have some options. I think calling is superior here.
It might be me versus Felipe. We'll see.
So difficult to navigate these one overcard situations. Would expect Felipe to be betting for value here and protection.
Not really much. That's true.
So frustrating for Anton Wigg to miss the board there with Jack 10.
Alrighty. What happened? Oh, my lord. You are beautiful.
Tyler Kenney
really is the old ace king of clubs.
Showing such passion for the game. Obviously such desire. What a great spot for him here in his GPL debut.
You go for it right here.
All right. We got to make something happen in the next couple of months.
Anton's super short.
That's plentiful for us.
He's probably going to go.
And I got him.
I think Felipe, well, we saw him call with A6 earlier against Tyler, so we would imagine he's going to call here. The only difficult thing there is he was closing the action. If he called and Tyler went all in, he'd be forced to fold. So that's running through his mind. Not an easy spot for the Brazilian.
That makes our decision a lot easier.
Let's go.
And Anton with the suited jack.
Would have been ahead.
Flop him dead.
Good thing.
This is a long heads up match. Six max match.
Alrighty.
And Anton Wigg, or ace on the river, meaningless.
Nice hand, Anton.
And, you know, that actually puts Felipe in a difficult position. 10 big blinds for Anton, but Felipe with 15. And if Tyler can pick up the right sort of hands, he can really exert some pressure on these guys because they aren't going to want to bust. Unfortunate for the lad that he picks up 8-3.
King 6.
He could just set them all in, you know.
I've been raising here.
He actually, they can't do anything.
Force them to pick up a hand. I have them covered. They're not going to shove too light.
Yeah, I mean, this may well be the better strategy. Tyler Kenney with a very impressive small ball style. Mm-hmm. That Anton seems to be really paying dividends.
Or if Felipe goes all in, then, there's no way I'm folding.
Most common strategies. It's fun. It's fun to get to mix it up.
I think I'm going to tank a little bit. Make it look like I'm trapping. Since I did that in the last game to finish it, I'm going to tank for another, 3 seconds, and then I'm just going to call. It makes it look like I'm being sneaky.
Loving a bit of Tyler Kenney at the moment.
Let's take a stab at it. See what Anton wants to do. We'll bet 29.50. Where's my connection? Connection's being weird.
Tyler tanks. Tyler bets. Gonna have to call once and see what happens on the turn in position with this many backdoors. And so green high.
He calls.
And that's
an interesting card.
Very favorable card for Anton. Really interesting when it's king high versus queen high. Really interesting to see who merges on top.
Check it.
And now Anton with the opportunity to take this pot away from Tyler.
Queen high is right on the cusp of what I think is good. And I wonder if he's going to stab the river. But...
checks.
Try to show it down.
Right. So Anton feels queen high is too strong to turn into a bluff. Obviously,
is that the best hand? I think I have the best hand. He shouldn't have an ace. He got the best hand. I'm winning this.
That's so pretty good.
Ship it.
King high, good enough at showdown. Okay.
We got queens. All right. Hey, what do I want to do? I'm obviously min raising.
Look at these stack size. Anton Wigg under
Felipe,
on 5 big blinds. Felipe just on 10 big blinds. This is the deepest I think we've gone with three people. 2,000, 4,000 level. The last level, we still have three players.
That's something that I could show.
And fold. I think Felipe folds because Anton's so short. Such a great position for Tyler Kenney getting walks. and tough spot for Felipe. He shoved.
I was going to fold here, regardless.
Yeah, with this good of a hand, we're going to have to gamble against Mr.
Anton is going to be gambling with a dominated hand. This is a big moment for Felipe Ramos. And he flops Anton, almost dead, 2%.
Okay.
A 10 on the river, a little bit of light for the Swede. GG, Anton.
And we lose Anton Wigg, also known as Antes Vanti, in third place.
Felipe, round two.
And round two between Felipe and, of course, Tyler Kenney. The two dark horses. This is our storyline.
Amazing stuff. Great performance from both players. Felipe charged into a chip lead, then has played pretty conservatively. Tyler was the short stack for so long, battled, made some really unconventional raise folds, but you know, what a strategy it's proved to be. Heads up here with the opportunity to go two from two. But both of these guys can be so proud already of what they've achieved here on the beginning of week three.
Here. I just don't like checking because it gives them incentive to bet on the turn. So I at least like stabbing at it at like 2,900.
Conservative check, yeah, with King Jack off. With 14 bigs.
Ooh, why'd it come through as 4,000? I'll take it regardless, but what was did not mean to do 4,000.
What was he trying to bet?
That was supposed to be 2,900.
Yeah, you can't, still, you can't bet under out. A big blind is why for Tyler Kenney.
Check here. Deuce, eight, two hearts.
We can see this is a very good strong for Felipe Ramos's actual hand. Tyler might suspect queen high is good a percentage of the time. But okay. Not much you can do without any clubs on board.
Me and Felipe again. I believe Felipe is a wild card as well. So we have the back-to-back wild card heads up, which is kind of cool. I like it. Now we go for the first. Oh, my Lord. You are beautiful.
And Felipe, again, checking beautiful, King Jack High and then Ace High.
Okay.
Or in the big blind.
We're obviously going for a min bet here. After we take, like, another 5 seconds and we bet.
Huge flop, obviously, alrighty, for Tyler Kenney. And Felipe.
Let's close it out high. For Team New York Rounders. Okay. What are you going to do, Philippe? What are you going to do?
And I don't think there, pretty hard to win off. If you're folding queen
for
high
sure we were.
From the small blinds.
A6.
Just relying on.
Got like 12 blinds.
Getting good hands.
There's nothing else I feel like I can you do, know, but
you're gonna get go dealt all this in kind here. Of junk.
I'm not looking to limp call. I don't. A6 isn't that good of a hand to do that with.
Mm-hmm. And like, we do have Felipe.
Previously with Ace-9, it dominates so many of his aces, but A6 is very much I don't want him to be calling with or shoving his Queen-10s and stuff like that. So we'll just take it down.
Felipe gone a little card
and
dead.
We'll take that down too.
At the wrong
with
moment.
Ace-2. 8-2. Jeez.
Tyler realizing
I mean, regardless, this is unbelievable. We want to have the king nine here.
High, so you guys know that whenever the blinds are 2,000, 4,000, I've studied the structure. You can't go higher. We need a little hands here. And hopefully those 65, 35, 64 is going to go my way this turn, this time. All right. Let's do something. Different angle here, still plenty of blinds, same lines, but the bottom, the game is gonna be pretty check. Even. Yeah, check it back. Now we got that. Good shot.
Last game.
It's high. It's probably good for us.
I ain't got nothing.
Yes.
Plus, he probably does have a lot of aces here.
Let's try and make a C bet. Works. Let's go.
Felipe, a little bit in less high spirits than last time we saw him. Obviously, given his chip position, things are pretty grim for him the moment. Obviously, so competitive. And Tyler limping King
Foxy. So silly. It's such a shove.
I mean, he's flopped.
A bad flop for
flopped us. Strong again. But yeah, letting him in with hands like 7, 7-6 off or whatever.
Really hope I'm making my guys at home proud.
I feel like if I bet a little bit more, then it doesn't look like I have the king. It looks like I'm trying to steal it. So I think if I bet like 5,500, I think I could get him to go all in every once in a while. Withdraws. And it looks like I'm stealing it. I've been min betting on hands that it looks like I really have it at points. I mean, right now I really have it. Top pair in a limit pot.
Oh, man.
I'd love to see Felipe find a shove here. If he's going to win this match, he's going to need to have a slightly more aggressive shoving strategy. These suited hands, 9-5 suited, it's like you can actually jam that with 10 bigs.
You get a flop like that.
Flop.
I mean, our criticism completely unjustified as they just flop massive.
Not an ace highboard.
But
hope he's like tired of letting me do this. So
wild. I was down to what? 3,000 in chips?
Yeah. Tyler pointing out it's how short he was.
Never, ever, ever, ever over.
Lost a big flip against Jake Cody.
Running good. Which ace king is what I've been doing, I believe. Is running pure. Running absolutely pure.
Oh, man. It's a little king.
We're going to keep limping.
Queen 7.
I think these guys have seen like the limping strategies, and now they're just taking it a little bit too far. There's just no need to be like limping when people are folding so much to min raises and
the draw.
If they knew how tight each other were.
I could check here. But I'm not going to because I want to be the aggressor. And he's probably not going to jam too much. He'll call more than he'll jam. So we'll bet 4,000 and see what his reaction to that is. Shouldn't have king 10, shouldn't have king
3. Let's go. Nice little...
should just be good there.
Strategy over here, trying to be alive, but like getting some crap cards, which is no big deal. Let's go.
And this is going to be an all-in.
You know what the deal is. We got a pair. He's got 10 big blinds.
Oh, yeah, let's go.
No thinking.
Oh, pocket three is
dominated. Deuce.
Time.
Big flop for Felipe Ramos. Vamoo for the Sao Paulo Metropolitans. A three required for Tyler. Otherwise, Felipe's.
Yes, nice double for Felipe.
Tyler.
That was close.
So close to making history for the New York Rounders.
Vamos, Sao Paulo Mets.
But Felipe back in it.
Nice. Hand.
And actually quite a lot of play in this when they employ these limping strategies.
Threes against ace deuce, like what a dream. That was like such a dream.
Yeah. Tyler, of course, pointing out that when he gets caught snap called there, the only hand he really such does want to see is ace deuce or king deuce suited.
Let's go.
They actually do both play pre-field fold. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
We're going to min-raise here. Make it look like we're stealing. I think he'll... he'll go... Oh, I have 2 minutes. So we're kind of in the same situation as last time, where I need to be careful with my clock.
A very technical game. A
decent amount of time. Blinds are relatively big, so my decisions shouldn't take...
I like to fold this, but like... Queen 8 such a good hand, heads up play. I do think has a strong range. Otherwise, he will go limping or
Felipe raising. Correctly identifying that he betting. Does have a stronger range when he raises that.
Betting for sure. Very what do I bet? Felipe. I'm betting 5,500. Because it just looks like a flop that I can just take it down, like easy.
Full most of the time, but unless got a pair, very hard he has five. Let's try and it's such a work a little. Not
calling. He could call it king high.
And it looks like Felipe
differently because most of the time it's gonna miss the board. It's not gonna show those ace highs and all this stuff.
He shouldn't have ace high.
So let's try this play.
Flop, he's gonna do a mini check raise.
I mean, repping very polarized here with the queen eight.
Can I click it? Can I click it on him? Can I click it? Is the question. Why yeah, would... because if I call, it just it looks like I kind of have it. So, like,
go ahead and fold.
Why don't we just, plus you know what? We have only like a minute left, a minute 15. Our time's like slowing down, but our decision wouldn't be so easy. So I'm just gonna take another 5 seconds and I'm gonna click it back. If he has it, he has it. If he's got a five, he's got a five. Like, what can you do? I just have to.
It's definitely capable of doing this with a five or a nine, but most of all, he's gonna just flat. I'm just going to go for a crazy bluff over here.
Felipe, go for it. Fasten your seatbelts, ladies and gentlemen. Brazilian poker.
Oh, thinking. Thinking. That's it. Really good. So now I'll just put
he's
a
got
four.
Me. He's got me.
Ah, oh. He's nine.
Felipe needs a queen or a six.
Oh, it's a good card. Queen or a queen.
Deuce it.
Or six or a queen, I mean.
It picked up and Felipe.
Oh, I mean, the way I played it, it looks like I shouldn't really have a nutted hand. It's just when I call, it looks like I'm strong compared to clicking it back. It's very much weaker. So that's kind of where the mindset was going into that hand.
Just went for it. It's a nice little shove. Let's go back to this game.
I mean, I hope you guys have got yourself comfortable. Maybe this is going to go on all night.
Six. What? I don't want 10-6. I don't want to let him back in the game either. I'm going to fold here. I'm not sure if that's a good fold or if I should be calling or if I should be putting pressure on and going all in to put pressure on him. I have Jack 10 off here. I'm going to be calling when he goes all in.
Big
for sure.
Oh, yeah. Encounter now. Yeah. Tyler Kenney needing a jack up. Whoa. Felipe flopping strongly. Queen for a sweat. Come on, queen. Bricks off. Felipe Ramos right back in it.
Back to even, Felipe.
Wow. Jeez. Amazing
back in
stuff.
The game.
These go, two.
Go. Oh my God, I got 36 seconds. No way.
And Tyler.
Oh my Lord.
Doesn't I feel in this situation doesn't have much to complain about because he has been.
I'm moving. We're moving quick.
Sort of tanking unnecessarily.
Game is tied again, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, big hand for Felipe.
Shit. We're gonna move quick. We're checking.
Let's try a little trap with this eight to check it back.
And flops Tyler it. Flops top pair. Check. And this is where having a short time back might actually hurt Tyler.
See, this is like a weird spot because he just like called and like, I feel like I can go all in for value.
Shoves and Felipe.
Because like, it looks like I'm on a serious draw and I don't have it. So I feel like you should be able to call with like a four or a three.
Let's go and win this hand, please.
Felipe calls and Tyler Kenney in trouble now. Seven for a chop. No, seven wouldn't chop. A deuce for a chop.
Will you do that for me?
Bricks
no.
Off.
Nice hand, Felipe.
Oh, Tyler Kenney. So close.
That's very good.
That
very
clock
good play,
really threw me off. That was a nice hand.
Let's do this.
Nice hand, Felipe.
Let's do this. We're due to all in, São Paulo. Let's
all right,
win.
We're all in for all of our
vamos,
chips.
Vamos ganhar essa parada.
Ace five.
Lethal Labor is so hard.
It was never going to be easy. I feel like it's never over with this order.
Nice answer.
Tyler Kenney, he has come back from two big blinds. Let's see if he can come back from one big blind now. Trebling up to three big blinds.
I don't know.
Queen high is good.
We're in there with 8-3.
Let's go.
Unfortunately.
Tyler, but forced to call it off with 8-3 off.
Yes, it's good.
The queen
Let's go.
Is the thing.
Three or an eight still needed. Slightly less outs for Tyler. Three or an eight.
Five outs.
Oh,
man. Come on.
Amazing.
Jesus.
The river card.
I feel like Sao Paulo was ready to explode there.
Still got this.
This is too good. Oh, what do I do here? I think I'm just all in. It's for like five blinds. I got to put the pressure on. I can't be in the big blind for like no chips. It's tough for him.
Felipe just calls it off with 3-4 suited now to gamble. And Tyler Kenney.
Oh, man, what a flop.
I'm kind of
Why did he call
in
this?
The lead here. I'm kind of still in the lead here. Oh my god, I have 1 second?
Tough guy.
What is this?
Tyler Kenney is on the hot seat with. He's doubled back up to over 10 big blinds. He was down to one big blind. He was down to.
Five,
this is an amazing match.
We got to be so
100%.
Quick. Oh my god, we got no time. I'm like, so, like.
Well
got
done,
no
well
time.
Done, well done.
It's pretty much like. Let's gamble! Gamble for it all, boy. The hot seat. It's the wild card hot seat.
Tyler Kenney referring King to the four. Fact he was picked as a wild card for the
What's he going to do?
New York
He's Rams. Got 2 minutes still. Fold here.
Nice little steal.
It's kind of tough. Maybe I'd need the jam there. But let's see how easy it's going to be to get that jam button. All in.
All right.
Oh man, I couldn't even get to all in time. Jeez,
very,
I guess I got a min raise.
Very, very tough.
Oof, that was bad. That was bad, bad, bad. All right, my mouse is gonna be closer to the keyboard from now on.
Let's go.
And we're just ready to be in there and win hands. Yeah, I know. I just got a message saying remember act within 2 seconds. I really did try. I'm just not quick enough.
And it's really hard with spots like that with queens. Queen
because that was a beautiful hand.
A
Maybe he had ace king. I think he had ace king in that hand.
Doesn't expect me to be showing like a strong range like that. So
all right.
That's why I tried something a little different.
This is dangerous stuff.
Let's check it. It's pretty good for.
And Tyler's got to be careful not to like time down here.
Considering he's folding a lot of hands and folded again. Nice. Let's go.
My calls throughout the whole tournament in order to
King Jack and it's over. Let's go. Let's finish him.
Oh my god!
I pressed raise. Dude, I didn't even press all in. I just pressed raise.
Ah, 5-6.
Shit, man.
Oh, hot seat disaster here for the New York
time.
Grinders.
Hot
seat about half a dozen times, but
that was brutal.
Everyone else has been able to make sure they get it in there, and not working out for Tyler Kenney of the Rounders right now.
Fast, I'm going for this time. Trying to finish this game. Let's finish this game. Ah.
Oh. all right, next match. We won't take nearly as much time for decisions.
Felipe is so pumped right now that he might.
Instead of pressing all in, I just gotta press min raise, I guess.
Let's do this. King 6. Game over. Oh, geez.
Unfortunate situation for Tyler Kenney
really
here.
Did have a chance
on the hot
game. Game over.
I mean, we're all in.
Let's do this for São Paulo.
I just gotta keep looking
for
it because like that's how I
Let's
get
do this
it in.
For São Paulo.
So 8-9.
He does flop.
Good flop.
Stop deuce. Trying to make São Paulo happen, Felipe.
Deuce.
Good turn card.
Blackjack's turn. I deserve. Oh, man.
Flush for Tyler Kenny. Amazing
all we
match.
Do is win flush. Hands.
Jeez.
When we get it all in.
133 hands his matches lasted. Incredibly long match for a six max.
Is he going to get it in time? Oh, he min raises.
Min raise. That's just my strategy. I have to min raise from this point and then decide whether I'm going to call off for the rest of it. I just don't have enough time to... Oh, let's get ready to call.
Equities.
I don't have enough time to make decisions, to press all in, and then get it in. So,
let's go.
Felipe Ramos with the luxury of 1:30. But not...
So we're going to min raise with what we think is min raisable hands. And
jeez.
And we're going to call here when if he goes all in.
I'll give you that for sure.
Tyler calling with the dominant
really quickly
ace.
Call. Make sure we don't miss that. Six ball.
Oh, three,
three, four, five, six.
Seven,
we got a seven. We got a
seven.
We got a seven. We got a seven. We got a seven. We
got
a deuce.
Six, seven, or a deuce.
And we got a seven. We got a seven. And we got a deuce. No, we don't. Good game, Felipe.
And that's a win for us. Let's go, São Paulo. Vamos. É isso. É isso que eu tô falando, garoto.
Oh, sorry, guys. Oh, yeah, that was quite an exciting match. how many hands was the total? 136 or something like that? The longest match in GPL history, obviously, in the six max. We're going to be interviewing Tyler. He's sticking around for us. Unbelievable. Both of them go heads up in both of the matches, both the dark horses, and it was just craziness.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, amazing stuff. Firstly, four players getting so, so deep in the six-max structure. The deepest we've seen, four players remaining. Then three players hanging around, and then an epic heads-up back and forth between Tyler Kenny and Felipe Ramos. These two guys coming in as wild cards, not necessarily, you know, people from North America, people from Europe, not knowing quite so much about these guys and their background, but they put on a great show for us. A lot of emotion, particularly on the Brazilian side. That is the first win for the Sao Paulo Metropolitans. Absolutely massive for the Brazilian fan base, and Felipe representing his home city of Sao Paulo.
Yeah, a huge turnaround for Brazil. But let's head to the lounge where I believe Laura and Eric will be... Not yet. Sorry, actually. We're going to be sticking to the...
It's such a pro.
Just, yeah, I know. Just now you broke our screen. Yeah, just an incredibly long match. Obviously, the highlights being Felipe. I mean, 12 points for Brazil.
Yeah, I mean...
They needed this turnaround really badly.
So just to recap what happened, Felipe, who came second in the first match after having a big chip lead, also put on a great display early doors, you know, had a favorable run of cards, but amazing hands, slow played pocket jacks against Maria Ho and won a big pot, had a huge chip lead, then sort of played conservatively and let the others go to war. Jake Cody winning a big flip against Tyler Kenny, and then that big all-in A6 versus A7 where it ran out of chop and then Tyler Kenny hit his kicker out of nowhere to cripple Jake Cody.
Yeah.
You know, such, I mean, that seems like so long ago.
Yeah, it felt like days
but
ago.
But huge back and forth. You know, smart strategic play from Anton Wigg, who, you know, I think ground out as many points as he could, given what the hand distribution, securing a third place finish for San Francisco Rush. But amazing to see those two guys heads up for the second time, you know, on webcam. And, you know, it was really, really great to see. Obviously, people that, you know, people questioned about the GPL. Will people care about their franchises? Will they care about the team? Tyler Kenny and Felipe Ramos. Felipe representing his home city. Tyler representing the franchise where he's been picked by his older brother, Bryn Kenny. I think we saw that those two guys really, really did care about their team and care about securing the points they could for the respective franchises.
Yeah, and in that second match, we really learned how unforgiving the hot seat really is. There were some complaints by the fans early on about, you know, maybe it's being too quick, but then we did see a lot of matches where there were people that were able to get to it right away, that you have to be really, really quick on the trigger finger, figure out what works for you. It is a punishment for taking too long over the course of the match. So obviously Tyler learning very early on that he needed to be quicker, and this is something that the players are going to learn to work with, as I know, we're not going to be making any changes to it.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think it is a very unforgiving, and perhaps I don't know whether there will be changes to it. But Tyler Kenny was someone who said in the first match and said again there that he even when he was down to a minute and a half, he still wanted to take, oh, I'm going to take 5 seconds longer before I make this move. What the hot seat is in place for is to cut that kind of behavior out. Exactly. What we want is, you know, to provide entertainment, like move poker to an area where it's for the fans just as much as it's for the players. So if you've got a legitimate decision, of course, there should be ample time for you to make the decision. But if you're taking 6 seconds to balance your timings, perhaps that's going to be the thing that you're going to have to cut out or face the kind of hot seat situation that Tyler faced there.
Yeah, and you even heard one of the players remark, you know, at some point during the two matches, it might have been Felipe that he said, you know, as soon as he starts tanking for this amount of time, everyone knows he's going to be three betting because he is trying to stay balanced. And we understand that, but it's just that dead space. It's just like, it's just slowing down the game and it's becoming a problem in the live circuit. So, yeah, I mean, don't take too much time at the GPL or we punish you.
And yeah, another, I mean, there were so many memorable moments I felt in that match. And another one was an amazing raise fold with ace, deuce of diamonds. Tyler Kenney, I think, had 11 big blinds on the cutoff. And instead of just moving all in, he min-raised. Jake Cody's there with pocket kings on the button. I mean, I couldn't work out exactly what Tyler's strategy was at the time. He raised, Jake goes all in, and he makes the fold where I feel like, you know, 90% of the players in this Global Poker League would be all in there, ace, deuce versus kings. So in that situation, it worked out perfectly and an amazing, amazing strategic choice from Kenny. And I'm really pleased for the lad that it worked out.
So we have something a little special here for this post-match because it was such an epic and long match. The guy still wanted to stick around even longer for another interview. So we're actually getting both of them for an interview. Let's go to the lounge where Eric and Laura are waiting with both players.
Thank you so much, Sam. Thank you, Griffin. What an exciting six-max match that was.
I think both of them were so exciting. This one lasting about 30-some hands, more than the other one, which was also an epic heads-up matchup. So two exciting matches by the two wildcards.
It was like the Felipe Tyler show more than anything, wasn't it? We thought that Mike McDonald might steal the limelight, but not this time.
No, I think we'll have a disappointed Timex, but not a disappointed fan base. I think that the people really enjoyed the match. The Twitch channel was buzzing with comments from both sides, the Go New York and the Go Brazil, so it was fun to see.
It was just the way it kept going back and forth, and Tyler kept coming back from, like, absolutely nothing. He came back, I think, three double-ups, like, against Felipe at one point, wasn't it?
It was on both sides, Tyler refusing to lose and Felipe refusing to not go home with a victory for the Mets.
I know, exciting. And we hope for them both to be joining us, something new and innovative in the studio this evening. We're going to have both of those players join us on Skype, hopefully, at the same time on our video wall. We're just waiting to connect them. And in the meantime, tomorrow's Heads Up match, really exciting stuff coming up there as well. Oh, there they are. Congratulations, Felipe. This is the first win for the Sao Paulo Mets. How did you enjoy that game?
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Feels amazing. It feels like we were due to a win. Hello? Can you hear me?
We hear you.
Okay. So it feels amazing to have our first win. We're due to that win after, like, the very unfortunate past week, having some of our best players couldn't score the way that good they play, the way they deserve. So I'm really happy to do this for them. And we are a team. I'm pretty sure that they're coming strong next time and are gonna not going to miss any other points. And São Paulo is going to go from bottom to the top.
Well, speaking of the top, the New York Rounders now sit first overall. Tyler Kenney, talk to us about the thrill of being able to play for your brother and the pressure that you probably have in the family that Bryn picked you as one of the wild cards.
You guys hear me?
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Okay. Bryn told me about the Global Poker League about a few months ago, and I was a bit busy at the time, but looking to really jump back into poker and challenge myself in the game. I've had a lot of history within the game where I've played a bunch of tournaments. I've made some deep runs. I've had major finishes, third places, fourth places, fifth places. But whether it's misplaying end game or whatever it is, I've kind of had trouble getting that first major victory for myself. So I really feel like the Global Poker League is a nice opportunity, not only for me to be able to play six-handed, where it's so important at the end of a tournament or during a cash game, but once it gets down to the three-handed or the two-handed, that's end game. So it gives me a chance to play against some of the best players in the world that have already ended games on multiple occasions. So it's nice to challenge myself, and I really feel like I'm throughout the season going to be up to the task. And I never feel like an underdog in any tournament or any game that I've ever played, and I'm just excited. It's a great start for me. So nothing really went wrong, except for I'm extremely competitive, so I'll take the double victory. I didn't get the double victory, but you know what? I was down to 3,000 in chips, and to come in second place was great for the second match.
Felipe, we heard you a few times talking about not just that this is not just the GPL isn't just for you, isn't just for your team. It's for the city of Sao Paulo, the country of Brazil. Talk to us about how Brazil is just in love with poker right now.
Yes, that's just it. Like, we have a very, very big poker community. And we are very, very attached. So if I go and go travel to play some EPT or some WSOP event, seems like I'm already at the final table when I go inside the plane, you know? So everyone's already cheering and sending their good luck vibe. Plus, we're passing through legislation in Brazil, which is getting poker 100% approved by now. So we're waiting on the next couple of days. But we're already winning over here, as poker is already considered a sport, such as football and volleyball, which are our biggest sports in Brazil. And so that's why we play for them, we play with them. That's really awesome.
Tyler, we sensed your anxiety when that time bank hit zero. How nerve-wracking was that?
It was extremely nerve-wracking because I had some premium hands. I had A7 at one point where I don't remember if it was a call where I was supposed to be all in, but I went for the all in and I missed out on the opportunity because that extra second just took over for me. So I think moving into this tournament, moving into these matches, I really didn't want to act quickly on decisions or too quickly on decisions, because it makes things look a bit standard and it's like, oh, he must have a hand just based on the quickness of his decision. But I really am going to have to speed up my game moving forward in these other matches to make sure that when I do get heads up, I'm not pressured to have these two-second decisions.
Guys, talk to us about the future. Maybe Felipe first. Must be excited to get right back in the ring, in the GPL ring.
Oh yeah, that's good. Like we never thought we were gonna be running against. Anything. But it's pretty good to acquire some points by now. And be very comfortable to play our best game. It doesn't have that feeling that we need to win, you know, because like all the teams are pretty crazy. I told this before the game started. One of my toughest opponents and one of the best players I played against was exactly Tyler, which I played a couple times in the MTTs around the world. And he's really, really good player. You see that whatever he's saying right now, which is like he's trying to improve already this game. The match isn't over yet. And he's already thinking about how improving his speed, his thought process, his method. That's really tough competition. I know that, as he said, he doesn't feel as an underdog and he shouldn't be feeling as an underdog at all. But like sometimes, even if you don't feel that, like, it's really hard, man. You're playing like we were playing today against, like, some of the best, like Jake Poggi, like Mike McDonald, for instance. Like, these are the best players in the game. I'm a big fan of all these players, especially Donald and Poggi. And so we hope we have our game in shape, which I mean that I studied a lot to play into this structure. So, of course, I was thinking about the time bank, and thinking about the gaming structure, try to change gears a lot of the time as the game was up and running. So I think if we keep that in mind, with the strategy in line, we have a shot on qualifying along these great players and teams.
Thank you so much for chatting with us, Felipe and Tyler. We hope to see you back in action for your teams very, very soon.
All right. Thank you so much. Let me just send a message to all my friends all over Brazil. Valeu, galera. Vamos, SP Metz. Vamos.
Am I still on?
Tyler, do you want a message now? We should let Tyler have a message.
What's my message?
Anything you want.
I don't know. It's a good start for. Like I said, I'm very confident in my game, but I feel like I'm definitely one of the players coming to the Global Poker League. Which isn't as known. I mean, I consider my brother Brent to be one of the best in the world, and I'm gonna fight hard, and I'm never gonna be an easy time. Kenny brothers, look out for Brent.
Thank you so much there, Tyler and Felipe, playing for New York Rounders and Sao Paulo Mets. Sao Paulo Mets winning their first ever GPL match history.
I don't think Felipe Ramos is going to bed anytime soon. I think there's celebrations in Sao Paulo.
Ramos!
That's right. He's having fun.
Right, let's head back to the desk, back to Griffin and Sam for a few key hands.
Thanks to you, Laura. Yeah, very exciting day here to start off week three of the Global Poker League. Felipe Ramos making a big impression. Tyler Kenney coming out of there making a couple of really interesting, amazing plays. And a lot of different hands to talk about over the course of these matches.
Yeah, fantastic stuff. I mean... You know, Tyler and Felipe have made a big impact here on their debuts in the GPL, but not necessarily the strategies, you know, that other people, like a very different style of playing to Dominica, who also did very well, very different style of play to Anthony Zeno, who also accumulated points. So really, really interesting to see that there are different ways of approaching the game and different ways to securing points in the GPL.
Okay, so let's have a look at some of these hands right now between these two players.
For sure. I mean, as soon as they bring it up, I'll talk about a hand. But yeah, it was, I mean, you know, there was a lot of interesting hands. Felipe obviously played those jacks unconventionally at one point and won a big pot against Maria Ho. But this was a hand, heads up, where we saw perhaps what we expect from Brazilian players, a little bit out of the box from Felipe, and it sort of cost him dearly. Tyler Kenney came in for a raise, and I think he said at the time that he's going to call an all-in. He's raising here to induce heads up. And Felipe sensibly, you know, with queen eight, a hand that flops decently well. Strong eight or queen is going to be best on a lot of boards. Defense. And from here, it should be quite straightforward. Tyler Kenney flops a big top pair, ace nine on 9-5-5. Obviously, a great result for him. And, you know, Felipe, when he faces this bet, I think the standard thought process would be to think, okay, queen high could be good some of the time. I'm getting 4-1. You know, if I turn an eight or a queen, it's going to be good. A seven is a gut shot. A six is a gut shot. A 10 is a gut shot. A jack is a gut shot. They're all cards where I could make a move or, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But what Felipe does is Tyler picks a small bet size, and Felipe, I think, gets a bit, the creative juices are flowing, and he decides to turn his hand into a bluff with this very, very small polarizing min raise, sort of representing a five. Now, the action's back on Tyler. And once again, we see that we've got a creative mind at work. This is, after all, the brother of Bring Kenny, hashtag BK's world. And Tyler, I think he said it out loud, said, if I call here, it's obvious I've got a part of the board. Like, if I call, I can't be bluffing very, very often. So what he does then is click it back on Felipe and make a small re-raise to sort of keep bluffs in his range. Now, I would think that you want to call here and also call with some ace highs, call with some gut shots as well, getting such a good price. But Tyler takes his creative approach, and back on Felipe, this should now be the end of it, right? But, you know,
this is Brazil.
Yes, exactly. And this is what you associate with Brazilian poker, a little bit out there, very, very aggressive style of play, which we traditionally associate with Brazilian poker. A little bit button clicky. He makes the jam with Queen 8 off. Obviously, if Tyler's got a 5, he's basically drawing dead. I mean, as it is, Tyler calls with the 9 and wins a way bigger pot than he should do. Felipe turning a few additional outs for the gut shot. But holds, and Tyler Kenney didn't close out this match, but it came very, very close to. And I think that's, I think that, what that hand illustrates is the way these two guys approach things. This wasn't your kind of balanced, coolie style that we see with some of the players. This was a kind of more aggressive, button-clicky, leveling kind of battle, which we see from these guys and Anti Zeno and other players, and it's gonna be interesting to see how successful that is.
Yeah, I think it's kind of fun seeing the different tendencies of, you know, the different representatives of different countries. You said the reputation of some of the Brazilians online, very button clicky and a lot of big overshoves and a lot of fun, real kind of hands, and not fun necessarily in the way that someone like Federer Holtz would call a fun player, like a weak player. Just like it's actually a lot of fun. Vamos, yeah. Like there's a lot of, they bring a lot of fun to the game, and you know, it's interesting just to see the different play styles and watch these little different rivalries be developed, whether it's the Vladimir, don't call me Vlad, Troyanovsky against, you know, the philosopher Dominici, or, you know, this rivalry now developing.
I agree. But I think this was slightly different to Dominic and Troyanovsky. Well, certainly different to, like, Nananoko and Sam Trickett.
Yeah.
I think both these guys had actually a bit of camaraderie. They recognized that coming into this field, you know, they're not the headline name.
Exactly,
that's Mike McDonald. That's Jake Cody. Those are people with millions and millions of winnings and, you know, many, many titles. They recognized that they were both coming in, slight underdogs into this field, and they could feel really, really proud of what they'd achieved and how much they'd won for their franchise.
Absolutely. Well, thanks, Sam. Again, this is the Global Poker League, guys. This was the first day of week 3. We're very excited to have you guys here each and every day. You can tune in. We are on Tuesday through Thursday. We're going to be on once again tomorrow. We have some great heads-up matches, a lot to look forward to. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you then.
Thank you very much. Well, the New York Rounders flying up the Americas Conference thanks to Tyler Kenney's first and second place there.
Yeah, I don't think that would, that's the way the script was meant to play out. But yeah, I mean, it's a great day for New York, and I think they're in great shape heading into Thursday's heads up play. And so is Sao Paulo at this point.
Sao Paulo must be so happy with their first win there. Let's take a look at the Americas Conference. So, obviously, Sao Paulo were right at the bottom coming in to today, and now up to fourth place with 25 points.
Yeah, and there's actually a big logjam there at 25. Three teams are tied. Los Angeles has the first tiebreaker with most wins. Sao Paulo, now with their first win, has the tiebreak over Las Vegas. So, if the playoffs were to start today, Las Vegas would not be in the playoffs. So, we talked about that, Laura, about, you know, accumulating points is important. But though those wins do become an important part if there's a tiebreak, and Anthony Zeno's hard work in the first week, Duhamel and Cody the second week, or Allen this week, would not be enough for them to move on. So you do need those wins. That's why the Sao Paulo victory so big. But 12 points from both Sao Paulo and from New York today, it just makes a huge difference in the standings.
Who would you put as the man of the match, Felipe or Tyler?
I think it has to go to Felipe, because you could tell that there was more on the line for him than just winning for his team, just winning for himself. There is a lot of pressure for that this team in Sao Paulo. They aren't all Brazilian, but even those that were selected were, you know, selected strategically. Darren Elias and Byron Caverman, they fit part of that mold. So they're considered Brazilian for the moment, and will feel a lot of pressure from the Brazilian community when it's their time to play.
Tyler Kenney, though, very impressed, not just with his play, but how he was on camera. He came across very well.
Just like his brother, right? But a lot of swagger, a lot of confidence, and that's fine. That's exactly what we want to see from the New York
team.
The bad
boys of poker.
That's right.
Let's take a look now at the Eurasian Conference standings. So these were the matches. I can't remember what happened with these matches earlier on. We've had so much go on since then.
Well, we'll remember that Paris had a huge lead coming into today, and now the lead has disappeared. Tied with Hong Kong
indeed
in points, and Paris takes the tiebreaker there. But a lot of work coming up for the French team tomorrow because Fab Sewell, unfortunately, two disappointing results. He will, you know, he will be disappointed by those
as well.
Yeah,
only managed to score 1 point today.
That's right.
The
first match was quite exciting as the top six or the six players lasted so long that it was just a matter of time that someone would feel upset by that. So, just by the way, Rome and Berlin at the bottom there. Berlin, it's starting, situation is dire. 1 point in so much six max action from Dan Cates. That team is suddenly in trouble.
That team is in trouble, and Dan Cates will be back tomorrow to fight to try and win some more points for the Berlin Bears. Will he do it, though? You will have to wait and find out.
Right, the system, the sixth match for him, I think that's where he's at an advantage. So he does come into the match probably as a favorite against Nanonoko. That being said, Nanonoko was 3-0 the first week, 1-2 last week, and we'll see what happens now. Probably a 2-1 just to blend it all in. So we'll have to see what happens to Nanonoko tomorrow. Daniel Cates, it's funny because at one moment he said, it's for play money, no one cares. He brings that up a lot.
He cares, let me tell you.
He brings that up so much, and you can tell that he does care. Yeah. And it's just frustration. And again, he did play well, but just things didn't end up well for him. So we'll have to see what happens. But that match is certainly something of an exciting match. The second match tomorrow is London versus Paris. I mean, that's a big match, It could decide first place by the end of the day. Kurganov, of course, the first round pick.
Yeah, that would be good.
The hand-picked man from
Midboy.
And George Dancer, the battle of the hair. The loser will shave his head like we used to do in wrestling back in the day. Loser shaves his head match. I don't think either one would agree to that. And it'd be a shame if either would have to lose the beautiful hair. But that's the match that I think is the main event tomorrow. No offense to the other two matches. But Kurganov, really exciting. Dancer, exciting. Tim Adams and Sergey Lebedev both returned to heads-up action. They played week one.
We've seen both of them already.
That's right.
So, in fact, just Igor. Actually, we've seen Igor play in the six already.
Yeah.
So it's just George Danza who's making his GPL debut tomorrow for Heads Up. It's going to be an epic day of Eurasian Heads Up play. So you should join us that first match. As you just saw, it's kicking off tomorrow at 12 p.m. Eastern time. It's going to be Daniel Jungleman Cates for the Berlin Bears, and he's going to be facing Nanonoko from the Hong Kong Stars. So join us for that first match and the pre-show just before the first match as well. Hope you've enjoyed the show this evening. Thanks to the commentary team, thanks to Eric, and we will see you tomorrow.
't get enough of the GPL? Head over to globalpokerleague.com for the most complete and up-to-date standings, schedule, stats, and information on your favorite team, as well as full-length match replays, highlights, and epic hands from all of our matches, and much, much more.